the 23rd Psalm. For centuries, the 23rd Psalm has been one of the most treasured passages of the Bible. It is that familiar that even people who don't go to church recognize the words. They're among the most comforting of words, often being quoted in times of trouble and distress, and almost always being used when we have a funeral. There are many images in this psalm that hold particular meaning. One of the enduring biblical metaphors for God is that of shepherd. The idea that God, our Father in heaven, watches over us as a shepherd watches his sheep. The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. Both God, our Father in heaven, and Jesus, our Savior, are frequently described in the Bible as being like a shepherd who cares for and tends to a flock of sheep. This can be a difficult image for us in the 21st century. As 21st century Western Christians, we don't have a culture of shepherds, do we? Or do we? The clergy person is one reenactment of the shepherd role, overseeing two flocks of people, the Christian family and the wider, perhaps non-Christian community. Another shepherd is the home group leader, tending a smaller household-sized flock. But what about the politician as a representation of the shepherd pastor? Politicians both represent us to the wider world, acting on our behalf with our best interests in mind, and delivering to us the protection and leadership of the local authority and the government of the day. Do you feel pastored by your politicians? Do you look to local or national politicians for protection, guidance, and leadership? If the answer to that question is a heartfelt no, and that wouldn't surprise any of us, would it? Then what has happened to our society that we have lost that kind of intimate, caring, responsible leadership? There has developed a disconnect between a biblical understanding of pastoral guiding leadership and our postmodern, secular, detached, professional political leaders. We must pray for more leaders to know more of God and be more willing to represent his ways more often. He makes me lie down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters or quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the paths for his name's sake, those paths of righteousness, doing right. If we think of pastures, we might conjure up images of tall, lush grass, perhaps with some flowers and some trees around the edge. We might also think that the Bible's green pastures mean that God supplies all we need in abundance. But this isn't what David was saying. In the areas around Jerusalem, the hillsides are mainly dirt and sand. There's not a lot of lush green grass. Mostly you'll find rocks and maybe a sprig of grass popping up here and there. These are the paths where the local shepherds herd their sheep. So what could David have been referring to when he says God makes him lie down in green pastures? Well, just as in England, in Israel, there are certain times of the year when it rains often and there are times when it's very dry. Psalm 23 verse 2 is referring to those dry seasons. And not just in the environment, but in our lives also. In Israel, the west wind blows its humidity against the hillsides, where it condenses on the cool rocks at night. And that little bit of moisture is just enough to grow those little sprigs of grass. If you step back from the scene after it rains, you'll see that those sprigs of grass on some areas of the hillside, facing the wind, looking for the moisture. These are the green pastures the Bible speaks about. Even during the rainy season, the grass is not plentiful. You can imagine how sparse it gets in the dry season. These dirt paths are where the shepherd allows his sheep to graze on those little sprigs. Not a lot of grass, just little sprigs of grass. Of course, sheep don't eat very much. We humans, on the other hand, eat plenty. We eat our fill and more. The dry sprigs the sheep eat are just enough to take a bite, then take a little walk further and take another little bite. The shepherd leads his sheep through the sprigs until each one has had a chance to eat something. Not a lot of grass, but enough for today's meal. This is how God shepherds us. He doesn't lead us into lush green cattle pastures where we have everything in abundance. Some days he may bless us with lots of sprigs, and other days there may only be a little, but there will always be enough for what we need. As for lying down in green pastures, the shepherd creates enclosures where the sheep can rest at night in safety, as well as to eat. Safety and encouragement. In this sense, the green pastures are a place for us to rest under the shepherd's watchful eyes. God doesn't make us lie down. He offers us peace and contentment every day for those who need it. That's a beautiful image, isn't it? It might change our perspective of what David meant by green pastures and how we understand what was going on in the Bible in those passages. Now let's take a look at the other half of that verse, what David meant by still waters. We all know how easy it is to get caught up in the daily hustle and bustle of life. There are not many of us who do things slowly and at a nice, easy pace. Our 21st century Protestant work ethic leads us to staying busy, working hard, managing our spinning plates, trying to find out the right work-life balance. Some days go by in such a blur that we hardly catch a breath. Well, God offers us a chance to slow all that down. These still waters we read about in Psalm 23 aren't swift-moving rivers, not even little streams, but shallow, quiet trickle of water, perhaps gently flowing along. And maybe you have a favorite quiet place, do you? That's still and peaceful. Where the water, the pace of life, is not deep, ankle high at most, and the flow is slow. The bubbling of the water is amazingly comforting and soothing. It's a place where you can breathe deeply and take in the sounds of nature. This is the type of still waters David is talking about. A shepherd would never lead his sheep to rapidly flowing waters. It would be too dangerous and too loud, causing the sheep to be frightened. God doesn't want this for us either. He longs to give us peace and rest and repose, so he takes us to where the water is pure and clear and almost motionless, so we can refresh ourselves in him. It's a place where we can slow down, be quiet and still with him, and experience intimately his deep, pure love for us. Because the water is so calm, we can even step into this living water and wade around a little bit, fully immersing ourselves in his grace and quenching our thirst. We might even fully immerse ourselves in the shallow water in an act of baptism, coming to the Lord to put ourselves in his place with him. That still water here at church is at the end of our service, when we have the opportunity to receive the Lord through what we call prayer ministry, where we wait upon the Lord for his words to us, his ministry to us. His invitation to drink of his peace is found in Isaiah chapter 55, which says, "Everyone who thirsts, come to the living water." And again, he reminds us in Revelation, "For the Lamb who is in the midst of the throne, the shepherd will lead them and give them living foundations, living fountains of water." If we remain preoccupied with our own busy agenda, we won't experience the serenity of the still waters or satisfy our thirst. We must actively seek him every day so that he can lead us in a continual place of rest. and prepare us for his kingdom's work. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness, or in the right path, for his name's sake. God doesn't lead us through these green pastures and through all these still waters just for our sake. It's all for his sake and his glory. And we can only benefit from these things because of his grace to us. Supplying our daily needs and offering us peace and rest are all part of God's desire to restore us, to restore our soul, to revive us in him. That's what this psalm is talking about, the revival of his people. It's only through his power and his grace that this can happen. He alone deserves the glory and the worship for it. So when you're feeling frantic or stressed or wondering how you're going to cope with a certain situation, it's Psalm 23. Allow Jesus, the Good Shepherd, to guide you along his path, knowing he has everything in control. He knows what you need, and he'll help you get there. All you need to do is trust him. Those green pastures and still waters are closer than you think. There is a spiritual reality every moment of every day. There is a faithful state of heart and mind available to us all the time. They are here with us right now. All we have to do is trust, believe, rest in him. Another image from this verse, this passage, comes from: though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. It would be so wonderful, wouldn't it, if God would simply promise to us that we would never go through difficult times. But we go through great and difficult, and terrible difficulties all of the time. God constantly warns us of these dangers and difficulties in his words to us. And Peter wrote in his first letter, "Dear friends, do not be surprised at the painful trial you're suffering, as though something strange were happening to you." So the Bible constantly tells us there will be difficult times in life. And Psalm 23 voices such a warning. It does not say God will keep you from danger, but rather it describes that there will come times, and they will come for all of us, when we feel like we are walking through a dark, dangerous valley. The valley of the shadow of death. But what the Word of God does make very clear is that as we move through such times, God is with us. God is there to comfort us and sustain us. The shepherd's rod is used to ward off animals attacking the sheep and to direct the sheep as they walk. The shepherd's staff, with its large crook at the head, is there to pull the lamb out of the thicket, which inevitably will get caught in. We can all say with confidence that as I walk through the valley of shadow of death, as I walk through these difficult times, I will fear no bad thing, because you are there with your rod and your staff to guide me and comfort me. He doesn't send us through the valley with a cheery promise to meet us on the other side. He goes with us every step of the way. Another image here in this psalm grabs our attention. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You probably all know the First World War story of the British and German soldiers playing football together between the trenches on Christmas Day. One soldier also wrote that some soldiers agreed to pool some of their meager food rations together for a Christmas meal. The soldiers of each side joined together and ate together and then sang a few songs together that had different words but common tunes. These were men who had been trying to kill each other the day before, men who had seen terrible pain and suffering and hatred. But there they were, eating together in the presence of an enemy. One soldier wrote that it was hard to go back to fighting the next day because he had shared food together with his enemy and they had sung songs of Christ's birth together. He said he had glimpsed a time in the future when all of them would be together in heaven and their earthly conflicts would disappear. Final image of the 23rd Psalm says, surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The conclusion of our journey through life is to be with God forever. In baptism, we are made members of the household of God already, and our destiny is made secure through our faith in Jesus. Sometimes the journey is filled with joy. Sometimes it's very sad and lonely. Yet the promise that God has already given us, eternal life with him, sustains us in our journey and gives us substance for hope for the future. The goodness and mercy that follows us are not something we achieve by ourselves. They are given to us by the grace of God. For it is God's forgiveness, our forgiving our earthly mistakes, that qualifies us for heaven. It comes from him to us. It's for us to take us back to him. With God, there is goodness and mercy evident in Jesus Christ, our Savior. Our life on earth and our life with God forever are the product of God's good grace for us. As we dwell on him, as we live with him and for him, as we come to him, we know that God's presence with us is there forever. This passage of Scripture, famous though it is throughout the world, is our assurance of our place with God our Father and our assurance of his presence with us this day.